What's up everybody, it's your boy Nibrash, and today's video is going to be about how Netflix is brainwashing us. What? Achoo. Bro. Chill. You're not a YouTuber? Video journal wanted to watch you. Udawana. So, first, who John Fisk is? Who is John Fisk? Video topic you will be. My topic is television, is on television culture. He was born in 1939. Whoa, that's a long time ago. Okay, what today's video is going to be about is today's video as if I'm on a Ponzista video. The video that I'm working on, the video journal's topic is television culture. And television culture came up from the book titled Television Culture, which was written by John Fisk. He's a media scholar, born in 1939. He was born in the United Kingdom. He's a professor. He's a communication arts professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and. Yeah, so in particular movies, so it's, there's nothing to, so he specializes in popular culture, cultural studies, media semiotics, and television studies. So we're gonna talk about mostly about television studies. So John Fisk wrote the book Television Culture, published it in January of 2011. Television Culture, the book written by John Fisk, I'm stating a line from his book. Television as culture is a crucial part of the social dynamics by which the social structure maintains itself in a constant process of production and reproduction. Meanings, popular pleasures, and their circulation are therefore part and parcel of the social structure. Okay, in the book, John Fisk defines both television and culture separately. Basically, what he goes for is television is more like a medium. So obviously it's a medium, or like a bearer or slash a provoker or of information through which culture is portrayed. What culture does is define entertainment or pleasure, or culture defines a way of living. Television does the job of getting that definition of living or lifestyle to the people. So what technology, and in this case television, is allowing us to do is new technologies, any sort of new technology is facilitating that social change. So I gave the example for YouTube and for Netflix, like big shows that, you know, have a different stance and is trying to portray a story. It could be a series or a film, anything. If Netflix were to be under television, the television category, I would say shows like Game of Thrones, where there's like really big like lead female roles where females are like, they're portraying characters that have such a big impact in the story, are so powerful. And for example, Khaleesi, or you know, Sansa Stark. Even like, I don't want to talk about Sansa Stark when she was young, because she was like, super dumb, but when she grew up, she's this freaking, like, I don't want to say goddess, but she was a freaking goddess. Like, holy, I was almost about to cry. This is YouTube, I can do that. And also obviously I'm doing this for a course. So these lead powerful female lead characters that are being portrayed in these stories, people like register these female lead roles, and slowly, like, I'm pretty sure these series have a very big part to play to easing people into understanding how powerful females in general could be. You don't have to have three freaking dragons to be powerful, obviously. Like, I'm talking about females in general as human beings. It is possible for them to be as capable as any man, and That's what these shows are doing. Television or Netflix as a technology isn't doing that. It's the content that is being made, and Netflix and television is allowing that content and information to be passed down to people all over the world. Since obviously television is a tool, it doesn't make a statement itself. It's more like, it's like a tool that can be used to make a change. The portrayal of the LGBTQ community in television, where like I've been watching The Boys recently, and they, one of the heroes in that, in the series, throughout the season, like we knew from the beginning that she was gay. They discussed up, they made a whole plot line around that topic. And even the fact that this is a part of a plot line of a series itself says a lot about how it is being portrayed to the public, and there's being light shed upon these topics. Obviously it does help in some way or another to shape culture and society. One thing that I've noticed, and ma'am also discussed it in class, was that nowadays television and film, but since we're talking about television especially, so TV series especially, these TV series, over the years, what they have done is humanized villains. Or what I mean by humanizing villains is they've given villains a personality that is relatable. Obviously there's like this badass vibe to them, like they're bad, like they're violent, or they're mischievous, or you know, they're clever, and we in some essence we want to be that. But other than that, they've humanized villains, and what that has done throughout the years is it made the distinction between right and wrong, it blurred that distinction between right and wrong. In previous films or TV series, there was this very fine line between the right and wrong, and we could tell that who's the villain and who's the good guy and who's the bad guy. But over the years, like it's changed. Like if, for example, Dexter or Hannibal, where the main character is supposedly the bad guy because he's a freaking murderer, but it's not like that because the story is being told in their point of view, and it's very hard to not sympathize or not understand or relate to that character because the whole story is being told in their perspective. So for example, in Dexter, like spoiler alert, when he was like a baby, like an infant, he saw his mother get murdered in front of him. No wonder he's all jacked in the head. No wonder he's a murderer and he loves to kill people. Obviously, like Joker. I know Joker is a more like a comic and movie thing, but Joker, like the one where Joaquin Phoenix is, it's a perfect example of, like, if anyone's watched the movie Joker, where, especially for the one for Joaquin Phoenix, because the other ones, they don't really tell the origin of Joker. But in this movie, beautiful movie, by the way, I highly suggest that you watch it. I'm not going to give any spoilers, but the story that's being told it's in the point of view of Joker. So Arthur Fleck, I'm not talking about the actor, I'm talking about the person who becomes Joker in the story. That movie portrays perfectly to the extent of trauma a person has to go through to be that much broken in the head and in the soul. Like that person, that Arthur Fleck or Joker, as Arthur Fleck turns into Joker himself. When I say humanizing villains, that is exactly what I mean. Like we as an audience, when we are seeing things in their perspective, we slowly start to understand what could have caused them to do it. What TV series has done is, I don't know, it made people, I guess, become more understanding of any situation. Like, people were so dead set into their ideals and beliefs in the past, but over the years, these movies and series, especially series, since we're talking about television, TV series have allowed people to relate to these characters, fictional or non-fictional. They have allowed us to improve ourselves as people. So since it's a lot of us, and it's not just me, I'm pretty sure there's a lot of people that have watched countless series and have learned from them, from the characters, from the plot lines, how they've related to their problems and understood that, maybe like related it to a level where they had to face a similar problem in real life, and they learned from these TV series and applied it in real world. So I know I have, so I don't know, I'm looking for a conclusion, but I don't have any, to be honest. I don't have a conclusion. Conclusion is that John Fiske is awesome. I wish I could read his book, but miss, if you can, like, man, if you can manage it, I'm a Dean. I'm really interested. I should have taken film. Why am I even studying CSE?